this panel is going to be a stew of generally applicable administrative law issues that really cut to the most important separation of powers questions of our day, and some of the substance, because it's hard to talk procedure without also having actual situations on the ground. So we're also going to be talking about some of the substance and the relationship between recent dear colleague letters, particularly in the area of sexuality and sexual assault and so forth, but with an attention really to the overarching questions of various ways in which the modern administrative state has centralized power in ways that avoid the safeguards that a previous generation imposed through the Administrative Procedure Act. Now, I'm not going to be presenting a paper here, and I'm going to introduce the others, but let me just make one remark about these cross-cutting questions, which is that in the wake of the recent election, we are at a particularly interesting and unpredictable moment when it comes to these essentially procedural issues, because on the one hand, the new administration may pick up these tools and use them for its own ends and have them thoroughly embedded in American practice, which will result in, I think, an administrative state and an executive branch which is essentially unchecked. Or, on the other hand, this might be a propitious moment in which some combination of constitutional conservatives and the president-elect's political critics might be able to reverse some of these tools. And so which way it goes, who knows, but maybe this panel is going to enlighten us as to how to do that. I'm not going to give, you can read the biographies of each of these folks, but let me just introduce them. Richard Epstein on my left,
uncharacteristically,
and he's going to lead off and give an overview of sort of how of the landscape here and what we're going to be talking about, and then we're going to have Richard Pierce, who's going to be honing in on getting into some of the weeds of administrative law in this field. Gail is our and until she goes to higher places, I signed that letter, by the way, and I'm really have my fingers crossed for you.
You guys overlapped in law school.
Maybe it's against you.
78.
But Gail is going to be talking more about the issues of substance. And then finally, Aaron Saiger is going to be talking primarily about the statutory background of these cases and how that fits in. So with that, Richard, each of them is going to be speaking for 10 minutes.
And 12! What is it, Lee?
12, okay. Well, I tried to save you all two minutes of each of them, and it didn't succeed.
Anyhow, you can nudge me at any time. I believe that temper trespasses as much of wrong as anything else. The question that Michael assigned to me is to talk about administrative law in the grand tradition, which means that I cannot be particularly specific with respect to any kind of agency or current controversy. And I think the way in which to begin this discussion is with a sobering observation that administrative law has always been with us. And so then the question you have to start to ask is, why is it that if it has always been with us, it is now with us in a very different form today than the form at which it had been so long ago? And I think the only way in which you could actually get at that particular question is to ask the relationship between administrative law on the one hand and a coherent system of common law rights on the other. If you understand that relationship, what you will then be able to conclude is that administrative law in its traditional form up through, say, about the 1880s was an aid of common law. And administrative law in the modern situation continues to have that old function, but in many other ways actually moves in the opposite direction and operates quite consciously in derogation of common law rights, and the new rights that it puts into place necessarily create a set of discretionary activities in the government, which it then becomes extremely difficult to chain in. So in order to sort of illustrate this particular contract, as I walked up here and prepared my speech, I said it's very interesting to talk about one of the great cases of the common law, which goes under the oppressive name of anonymous, which is a case involving public nuisances decided in the year 1535. And one of the things that one has to understand about judges from 500 years ago, just because they were long dead does not mean that they were always stupid. And these guys, in fact, were extremely astute in the way in which they understood the situation. And the question that they faced in this anonymous case was the way in which you integrate public and private enforcement of various kinds of rights when you start to deal with mundane situations like public nuisances. And these things could include blocking public roads or polluting public waters or anything of the sort. And the first thing that they did, in effect, in these particular cases, is they relied very heavily on the classic common law definitions of what counted as a nuisance, definitions which are by and large pretty constant over time, notwithstanding some odd statutory embellishment. And what they meant by this with respect to a public road is that somebody either damaged the road or blocked ingress and egress along and about it. And with a public nuisance on waters, it could be that too. Or in the alternative, it could be pollution from various kinds of sources. And the question then is, what sort of remedial structure do we give once we've decided that these kinds of invasive activities ought to be regarded as actionable? And the answer that they had was always in two parts. The first part said is we distinguish between general and special damages. And what that meant is if you have a large number of individuals who have small injuries of one kind or another, it becomes perfectly clear that private rights of action by everybody against everybody else are going to be a dead loser. So what you do is you keep the basic conception of what counts as a right and wrong, and then you have an administrative body which can tax the entire population and do so in a way which allows it to enjoin the individuals who are involved. And so what happened is, they said in 1536, that if there is one of these things which causes widespread general damage, you get fined in the court leet, and that becomes the sanction to try to reduce the overall level. And then when it turns out there are certain people who are especially inconvenienced and suffer special damages, that would be individuals who crashed into the situation, people who were poisoned by the water or whatever it is, now the size of the individual losses are sufficiently large that these people are allowed to maintain their private action. And so what you can see essentially is administrative law under this particular model is simply a transactions cost economizing device which is intended to reduce the scope of various kinds of wrong but not to redefine the way in which particular rights are going to be operated. And can this thing carry over to the modern times? Well, the answer is not only can it, but it does. It's one of the fixtures of modern law dealing with water and environmental stuff and so forth, that you could have a scheme which says that for generalized pollution, what you need is a system of direct regulation. Maybe now it's not going to be done through a court leet. It may be done through an administrative agency. But its particular job is to figure out the proper mix between damages, now called fines, and public orders, now as a variety of injunctions. And if you follow the common law logic on this subject, one of the things that you discover is that you always use these two sets of remedies in combination. You never want to wipe out any kind of activity because the last efforts of benefit cost you an enormous amount, and yet you don't want to leave these things untaxed, so you have a joint regime, and you can do that today. So if, in fact, you follow this particular model, it sort of generalizes very easily to modern technologies, and essentially the difference between modern and ancient law on this particular subject is the various kinds of empirical techniques that you use to measure, quantify, identify harms. Because when you're dealing with diffuse harms, often figuring out the source of something is extremely difficult. Anybody who spent the slightest amount of time dealing with issues about climate change and so forth will realize just how important these causation questions are. And the common law essentially started with push-pull relationships, which were easily observable on the theory that you want to invest your resources in controlling those things which have manifest harm of clear origins rather than going off into speculative situations. When you start getting into the modern administrative state, all of a sudden the objectives start to change, and it's important at this point to distinguish between two kinds of objectives. One kind of objective is, in fact, that which is covered by the first of the major American schemes, which is the Interstate Commerce Act of 1886, which was an important enough innovation at the time that it got Judge Thomas Cooley to leave the Michigan Supreme Court and become the first commission. And this is a kind of problem for which you do need an administrative law solution, for which there is no direct common law analog, because for the first time you're now trying to figure out how you organize the complex economics of infrastructure and network industries. And what you discover, all of this stuff coming to the fore in the last half of the 19th century, if competitive solutions are not going to be available, can you figure out an administrative system which will allow you to try to replicate the competitive rates of return in industries which are inherently monopolistic? And it's no accident and no mistake that this particular challenge comes up in three separate places at exactly this time. One of them is it's with railroad regulation. It's a huge network industry. Then you get public utility regulation for things like gas companies and electric companies, which had never existed before. And then you get very serious efforts at common pool regulation, because the exhaustion of natural resources by overhunting and overfishing becomes perfectly clear. And if you go through the cases between 1885 and 1890, these three threads are constantly moving back and forth. And the judges are struggling with them because the economics is not clear. When you get to the modern system, you're trying to do something very different. What you're not trying to do is to solve inefficiency problems or to reinforce common law rights. What you're trying to do is to redefine the world. And I could talk about any one of a dozen statutes on this, but let me just mention two of them as a kind of an easy way to get into it. You start talking about, for example, the spectrum as a new resource. One way in which you could try to define the spectrum is give interference quotients, give people, therefore, rights within the interference boundary, and let them do whatever they want on an analogy with private property. Now, but the Federal Radio Act comes 1 year after Euclid against Ambler, and instead of trying to simply determine the boundaries of private property, all of a sudden government is now trying to determine the composition of the traffic. You can have single-family homes in this part of town, apartment houses here. This broadcast spectrum goes for this. This one goes for that. The moment you put yourself into that particular situation, the demands on the administrative states are enormous, because nobody can develop a set of rules which coherently tell you how to organize the composition of the traffic. The problem is exponential in size, and the awareness of the difficulties from the change was completely oblivious to everybody who was doing it. As usual, the idiot savant in this particular story, in many cases, are people like Felix Frankfurter. Because what they say is, we know that the laissez-faire systems are all bad, so we're going to let some administrative agency decide how things are to be done. And then they have no idea, once they delegate it down, as to what that is going to happen. And the other disruption that you get in modern times is, instead of trying to figure out how you regulate natural monopolies, you're trying to figure out how to regulate competitive industries. So if you start looking at the National Labor Relations Act and the Fair Labor Standards Act and so forth, their central proposition is that all competitive markets are essentially disruptive and dysfunctional, and what you have to do is to regulate the ways in which these things are going, and for that you need to have a board. Now, it's one thing to figure out how it is that you enforce contracts in accordance with the terms that people choose for themselves, and it's not always that easy, but it's a vastly more complicated enterprise to force them either into various kinds of bargaining arrangements or impose various kinds of substantive terms on them. To just give you one example, which I always like to talk about, everybody knows what an hour is when you talk about a wage per hour, not when you have a Fair Labor Standards Act where the definition could be 100 pages. And so what takes place, and I'm going to stop right here, is this. If you're trying to do one of two things, enforce common law rights when transactions cost a lot, or try to figure out how it is that you deal with various remedial structures that are needed to handle the complexities associated with either common pool problems on the one hand or monopoly problems on the other hand, you can develop a tolerably coherent administrative law body. But if in fact your particular objective is to essentially transform substantively the common law rights so that property is no longer a right to exclude and develop, but it's a series of options for the government to tell you how you exclude and how you develop, or how you hire and how you fire and so forth. The task becomes exponentially larger. The burdens on the procedural devices will become ever greater. And what you will see is essentially judges who are very happy to announce the inadequacies of common law rules will then be thrilled to essentially let administrative agencies run amok on many of these questions, because they know full well if they actually have to identify the substantive parameters that they want to put into place, they don't have a theory to do it. And so essentially, it's the same story as we have everywhere. The intellectual poverty of progressivism is what has led to the decline of administrative law. Is that 12 minutes?
That's done.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Richard. And Richard?
I can't continue to address this issue on the very high level which Richard addressed it. I actually struggled with it quite a bit in 1536, but I was so young that I hadn't yet developed a coherent philosophy that I could apply. So let me just turn to a modern administrative law take on what we're addressing today. That a lot of agencies are doing a lot of things that a lot of people think are overreaching. And in many cases, they are taking those actions without any procedural safeguards at all, and with questionable judicial review powers thereafter. All of this takes the form, typically, of the title of our discussion today, something like Dear Colleague Letters, or What Can Agencies Do, in Guidance Documents. So let me just put this in administrative law language. there's no such thing as a guidance document. Somebody made it the term about 25 years ago, and people have been using it ever since. What there are interpretative rules and statements of general policy. And each of those shares a common characteristic. They can be issued without first going through notice and comment. And that's all we're talking about. We're talking about not whether you can do something, but whether you have to engage in notice and comment before you take that action. So a lot of agencies have been taking a lot of pretty powerful actions using these interpretative rule or general statement of policy exemptions and taking without any procedural safeguards. And I agree completely with Gail and others who have been critical of a lot of this as overreaching. And I get back to that at the end. But let me just lay out the basics and put it in context. Interpretative rules and policy statements, nobody knows exactly how many are issued every year, but we're talking many, many thousands. And they are all over the map. Lawyers and law professors have really an extremely distorted perspective on what they are. Lawyers are aware only of the something less than 1% that really upset their clients, where the client comes in and says, this is an outrage, get rid of it. Law professors are engaged with and upset about probably 1/10 of 1%, the ones that are pretty clearly overreaching on very important issues, and they disturb us as a matter of public policy that an agency can take an action like this. Well, that's a teeny part of the world, of these thousands and thousands. So what else is in that world? Well, let me hearken back, turn the clock back to the mid-70s. And in the mid-70s, because of an astonishingly stupid Supreme Court opinion, the federal government had to regulate the wellhead price of natural gas. That produced, inevitably, a massive shortage of natural gas, which in turn threatened to shut down large numbers of industries who relied on natural gas as a fuel. And so, at that time, I, along with Ron Levin, represented a couple of hundred industrial consumers, and we convinced the Federal Power Commission to issue a general statement of policy that said, look, if you buy the gas, if an industrial consumer buys the gas on the unregulated intrastate market, and then arranges to have a pipeline transported to their plant, we'll approve that on an expedited basis with just a 10-minute opportunity, 10-day opportunity for protest. We don't get a protest, it gets, okay. So 1 year later, we get one of the worst winters in history. It threatens to shut down and begins to shut down thousands of industrial facilities all over the country, puts millions of people out of work. They shut down the University of Texas for a while. And what came to the rescue was Order 533, that statement of general policy, where lawyers all over the country, I was one of many, who would then cut deals with producers, buy the gas in the field, cut a deal with a pipeline, file the application with the Federal Power Commission that would go through. And so there is an illustration, it's a rare one, but an illustration of a general statement of policy that had an extremely socially beneficial effect. Now, most of them don't have big effects of any type. Most of them are of no interest to anybody other than a few people. About half of them, at least, come as a result of inquiries that go something like this. You regulate me and you say I can't do X. It sure would be easier if I were able to comply with what you want to do by doing X prime. Can I do X prime? Okay, and the agency comes back and he says, yeah, you can do X prime, or you can't do X prime. And you want a particular result, but what you're happy with is a result. So you got some degree of clarity, you get rid of that horrible uncertainty that's a terrible nuisance for all businesses. And so that's 99% of what we're talking about. And what concerns me is if we focus exclusively on these overreaching cases, we could easily come up with a solution to a problem that creates a problem far worse than the problem we are solving. So I think we have to be very careful about it. I think the concerns are already, I think, a little bit overblown. A lot of people say, well, you know, with our deference, a lot of these are interpretations, they're interpretative rules that interpret legislative rules. Okay, so in that situation, the Supreme Court has held since 1943 that courts should defer to agencies' reasonable interpretations of ambiguous rules. And a lot of people say, well, that means they get a rubber stamp. Well, that's not true. It's never been true. I did an empirical study of that a few years back and concluded that the federal government wins 75% of those cases. Well, they lose 25%. Then right after I did that, the Supreme Court decided Christopher versus Smith Klein, 2012, and cut back on the scope of our deference in four different ways. And the studies since then have found that the federal government wins even a lower percentage of those cases. The deference is down some. So I'm not saying we shouldn't be concerned about it. I think we should be very concerned about it, and particularly the kinds of cases that have gotten the attention of Gail and others. But what we are talking about is relatively rare overreaching and what to do about relatively rare overreaching. And I think we might have had a solution, at least a directional solution, if Justice Scalia's untimely death had not preceded the setting of the Texas immigration case before the Supreme Court. As you know, that wound up with upholding by an evenly divided court, no opinion. My guess, this can only be a guess, there's no opinion, but my guess is if Justice Scalia had survived long enough to participate in that, it would have produced a 5-4 opinion, probably written by the Chief Justice, in which he said, this is just too damn important to do without using notice and comment rulemaking. And that would have created more of a line that tells agencies, well, you can't cross this line of issuing some proclamation without notice and comment if it's just too damn important. Now, there's a lot of problems with the important issue doctrine, but I can't come up with anything better, and I'm only speculating. And you know, that may be a part of the answer in the future. I add one more thing. I really think this looks very different in the context in which it's been applied a lot recently, in the context of spending clause cases. I don't think the government should get any deference at all when it comes to ambiguous provisions of a statute or a rule when we're talking about spending context, because the whole theory there is the state has accepted the funding, has accepted the conditions on the funding as part of acceptance of the funding. But that, to me, calls for a clear statement rule and not a rule that says that if the conditions are ambiguous, then the federal government, after the fact, gets to determine what those conditions are. So I'd also draw a line between spending clause cases and, say, commerce clause cases or tax clause cases. I think that's all I've got to say at the moment.
Thank you, Richard. Gail?
I'm here to talk about a few examples of the aggressive use of guidances and consent decrees and resolution agreements. Let me start by saying that I agree with Richard Pierce that there are a lot of guidances out there, and you know, a lot of them are non-controversial, but too many of them are aggressive. Consider, for example, the EEOC. Because the EEOC does not have substantive rulemaking authority, and that, by the way, was a very, very conscious decision by Congress to withhold that authority, it does a lot of its work through guidelines or guidances, some of which are phrased as safe harbors, in theory not binding, but in practice very binding indeed. Overwhelmingly, employers meekly follow guidances in order to avoid long investigations that otherwise might arise if they do not follow. What happened in terms of the law is that since 1972, when pattern and practice cases were transferred from the Civil Rights Division to the EEOC has been able to punish those who don't follow their guidances with those long investigations and with complex or sometimes complex consent decrees. The EEOC has thus had a huge effect on workplace culture, even at businesses that would never have dreamed of discriminating on the basis of race or sex. But they would have wanted, for example, to reject job applicants with felony records. But now they're told by the EEOC that unless they jump through certain hoops, they're not going to be able to do that. Even though you can look all over Title VII itself, and it doesn't much speak about these hoops that must be jumped through. Or there are employers who, again, wouldn't have dreamed of discriminating on the basis of race or sex, but they would have wanted to require their English-speaking employees, some of whom are non-native speakers, to speak English while on the job, rather than risk putting off customers who can't understand what's being said and therefore take offense. But now these employers can't do that, or at least they're told they can't do that, even though a number of courts have already agreed that this is not something that would be required by Title VII. The EEOC persists in that. Now there are several kinds of problems here. And you know, overall, I guess my question on these is, you know, is this the enforcement of law at all, or is it something else? First, there are guidelines that impose duties on regulated parties not imposed by the statute, but where the duty at least arguably could have been imposed by a rule after notice and comment. But the agency just didn't use it. They didn't use the kind of procedures that are designed for that. I think an example of that is the Department of Education's Dear Colleague letter of January 8, 2014 on school discipline. Which reacts to the fact that African Americans are disciplined more often than white students, who in turn are disciplined more often than Asian students in school. And the Dear Colleague letter essentially tells schools to ratchet down discipline in schools. You know, don't discipline the students so much because this is having a disparate impact on African American students. That's a quick summary. It's a complex guidance. But the Supreme Court has already determined that Title VI of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which is what OCR is enforcing, is not a disparate impact statute. It simply bans race and other kinds of discrimination in federally funded activities. Nevertheless, the Department of Education's Office for Civil Rights has continued in its insistence that it can prohibit actions that have a disparate impact. And indeed, they probably do have that authority when it's promulgated pursuant to a rule. That rule, a prophylactic rule, can indeed be based on disparate impact liability, so long as it's designed to effectuate Title VI's underlying prohibition and not for the sake of disparate impact itself. And the analogy there would be to the 14th Amendment. The Equal Protection Clause itself bans only disparate treatment, not disparate impact, but Section 5 of the 14th Amendment, which empowers Congress to effectuate that ban, allows Congress to promulgate prophylactic statutes that can, to a certain degree, take advantage of disparate impact theory, but it has to really be prophylactic. Congress's power under Section 5 is limited by City of Bernie versus Flores' requirement that it be congruent and proportional to an actual equal protection violation. A similar limitation has to be used for administrative agency conduct using rulemaking power pursuant to Title VI. And the Department of Education just can't magically transform an act that is not a disparate impact statute into one by willy-nilly issuing Dear Colleague letters, or just broad disparate impact rules, for that matter. All this is a very long wind-up to saying that it's arguable that OCR could have promulgated at least portions of its school discipline policy as a rule. There is some empirical evidence, I believe it's not very credible evidence, but at least it exists, that African-American students tend to be punished more harshly for the same misconduct. In other words, there's some, albeit inconclusive at best, on evidence of actual discrimination, a rule that required extensive record keeping, a rule that required extra bureaucracy before punishments can be meted out. Some of this stuff possibly could have been done through a rule subject to notice and comment, but that's not what we got. It's definitely not appropriate as an interpretation of Title VI. It imposes duties that are clearly not found in the statute. But what does a school district do in the face of such a guidance? It will obey, of course. And already we are seeing evidence that some of the inner city schools that have been forced to comply with this, already we're seeing reports of chaos in some of these schools where teachers, against their better judgment, are lightening up on discipline and getting chaos in the classroom instead. Why do school districts comply with this? Because a lot rides on staying in the agency's good graces. Disobeying is fraught with risk. The Administrative Procedure Act does not provide a clear procedure for challenging such a guidance up front. It's not a final agency action, or at least in most cases, the courts have been finding that it's not. A school district could disobey, could wait for OCR then to cut off their funds and then sue. But for many schools, the amount of money that this, is riding on this can be quite large, and they can't afford the risk that in the end, after OCR has cut off their funds, that the court will agree that OCR was acting within its rights to do so. Even for those who are getting only fairly small subsidies, they can't afford to be the tall poppy that gets cut down as a result of just the costs of an OCR compliance review. These things go on, and they're very expensive. They end up often resulting in resolution agreements that go well beyond what Title VI requires. Weirdly, therefore, the lesser power of issuing guidances can turn out to be the greater power when compared to issuing rules. In other words, in the absence of a clear way to adjudicate a disagreement over what the law requires. The right thing to say when OCR says jump is how high, not I don't think you have the authority to command me to do that. Here's a slightly different guidance problem. Guidance is that impose duties on regulated parties not imposed by the statute itself or by any duly promulgated rule, where the agency claims it is simply interpreting the statute or rule, and where it just isn't true. The quite extreme cases. And I think that's probably a case where the best example that's being discussed right now is the Department of Education's transgender bathroom, locker room, and shower guidance, which I'm sure you have all read about. In May of 2016, OCR issued a guidance telling schools that intact, anatomical boys and men who think of themselves as girls or women, that is, they think of themselves as transgender, must be allowed to use the toilets, locker rooms, and showers that are ordinarily reserved for girls or women, and vice versa. The guidance covers athletics, too, but it dresses it up in somewhat more equivocal language, but nevertheless, the basic rule that they're arguing for still applies. How much time do I have, Michael?
A minute and a half.
Oh, okay. I'm running out of time, so I won't explain why I believe this guidance is a serious misinterpretation of Title IX. Ask me about that if you want to, if you're not already convinced.
Please.
Ask during question and answer. But I did want to point out one encouraging thing and one not so encouraging thing about that case is we are starting to see some pushback there. I mean, not the case that's before the Supreme Court, that is Gloucester County School District versus Gigi, because that actually came before the guidance, and that actually is what inspired the guidance rather than the other way around. But the state of Texas, along with a number of other states, have brought an action, and the court found that there was a final agency action and issued an injunction. So that's sort of encouraging, I think, for these extremely invasive misinterpretations. But there's also an added reason that I wanted to mention, and that is the discouraging side of this. Generally, you get cooperation with these guidances because it's so very difficult to not render your cooperation, both with the EEOC and the OCR guidances. But in this case, there's an added reason, I think, and that is a lot of school districts really like this transgender guidance, not because they have a strong view about whether or not it's Title IX is being correctly interpreted or whether or not this is good policy. They just don't want to have to decide for themselves. They don't want to arbitrate between screaming parents on one side of the issue and screaming parents on the other side of the issue. And the reason I find that so very discouraging is what does that say about our political culture? When we've got, you know, political leaders, school board members, and school district officials who are just terrified to decide issues for themselves and start being happy when the federal government from inside the Beltway dictates local practice. I find that very discouraging. The end.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Gail. Aaron?
Good morning. Am I audible? Yes, good. I want to pick up more or less where Gail left off and say a few more things about these Title IX guidances that have come out of the department. Again, agreeing that these are the exceptions rather than the run-of-the-mill, uncontroversial guidances that have been mentioned several times. There is this transgender letter out there now. There's another one about the adjudication of cases of sexual assault, which has been very prominent in our own business for the law professors in the room. And I would just like to say at the outset that, without yet having heard Gail's answer, I'm in total agreement with it, that these are terrible pieces of statutory interpretation, and that Title IX does not say that these things are required, and that the regulations, the legislative rules that say that fair procedures are required, also do not require the things that the adjudication of sexual assault letter says must be done. And I want to say that, and now I want to set that claim aside and say a few things about what I take the harder question to be, which is, if one has a government agency that is devoted to bad statutory interpretation, to a particular bad statutory interpretation, is it bad that they're putting those bad statutory interpretations in these guidance documents rather than in legislative rules, and is there anything we can do about that, given the interpretation to which the agency is committed? How do we want to control how it should be expressed? And I would say that there is a strong view out there, Professor Epstein has expressed it among others, that the guidance is a particularly bad way to do this because the protections are absent. We don't have notice and comment, and it's hard to get judicial review, and judicial review is too deferential because of our. And that those problems mean that the agencies are using a procedural form which is particularly problematic. The agency's answer to this is very straightforward. In each of these guidances, there's a disclaimer at the top that says, this is just advice. You don't need to listen to this if you don't want to. And they write this explicitly at the top, right? Do not play with the bag of glass, right? It's a very straightforward disclaimer that this is just advice. And what is the harm in advice? And the rejoinder we've heard already this morning, it's an obvious rejoinder, which is that any normally risk-averse party will comply with this kind of advice. Professor Epstein has called this in print the velvet glove that conceals the iron fist. Judge Douglas Ginsburg, for whom I clerked 15 years ago, used to call this comply or die. This was the position of the Texas court that says that indeed the pre-guidance letter from the Department of Education in the GG against Gloucester School Board case was final agency action because it essentially did require school districts to obey. And there is this issue, of course, that investigation is the punishment in many of these cases because attracting the negative attention of the agency is often as bad or worse as the sanction that may result. I have a long quotation here from one of the reports about what was involved in the investigation, which I will not read you for reasons of time, but it is quite dreadful. So, therefore, require at least some of these controversial guidances, big problems, bad problems, something like that, to have some set of procedural protections. Insist upon notice and comment, make it easier to get judicial review, don't give hyperdeference to them. And my question for this that I just like to put on the table this morning, to which I don't have a full answer, is if I'm the agency devoted to this bad piece of statutory interpretation, and I face a new regime where I can't write this guidance the way I can write it today, but instead face additional procedural protections, or face less deference, or face a higher probability of judicial review, what do I do? And there really are two possible answers to this question, and it's very important to know which one will happen. And one of them is, I don't engage in bad statutory interpretation if I'm faced with these mechanisms that will get in the way of successfully promulgating really bad statutory interpretation. That is a good result. The other possibility is that I stop advising the public and that I just don't tell them. I don't write the guidance that says that I'm committed to this bad piece of statutory interpretation, but I remain committed to it. Now, of course, pure silence is different because agencies can't ask how high if they haven't been told to jump. So the option of pure silence is not entirely disturbing, but that's not the only strategy available to agencies. And I just want to say something about what I think is a very difficult problem to solve about another tactic that agencies have, which is to rely almost entirely on their enforcement power. Yes. So that's in awesome. The Gloucester County against GG, did they say, you pronounced it differently than I did. Am I pronouncing it wrong? Gloucester. Good. What that school board actually did in the face of not wanting to adjudicate between the pairs of screaming parents was they wrote a letter to the Department of Education to ask what to do. And they got back a long letter from a, what the cert petition calls a minor functionary at the Department of Education. I want to read you one paragraph from that letter. This is not the guidance that went out to every school district. It's the personalized letter that went to Gloucester. Here's what they wrote back. It may be useful to be aware that in response to the Office of Civil Rights' recent investigations of two complaints of gender identity discrimination, recipients have agreed to revise policies to make clear that transgender students should be treated consistent with their gender identity for the purposes of restroom access. For examples of how OCR enforced, this is Title IX in this area, please review the following resolutions of OCR investigations involving transgender students. And then there are two citations with a web address that you can pull up the resolution agreements. That's the quotation from the letter. Then the letter goes on to say, this letter shows that the position of the department is that you must do these things. But my question is, what if the letter had stopped there? What if the department had just written to the school district to say, you might be interested to know how we have resolved some cases that have come before us that we have investigated, the investigation being a big part of the punishment, and see the resolutions that we have come to, both of which also begin with a disclaimer which says, no party has admitted any violation of the law. We've just agreed, in order to get the department off our back, to do the following things. You might want to know that that has happened, and then the department says nothing else. We don't tell you what we think the law is. There's no claim in the resolutions of these cases about what the law is. It's just the way that the parties have settled the cases. My concern in this area is that as a threat, as a way to enforce obedience in a regulated industry to a bad piece of statutory interpretation, that kind of response is just as threatening, just as effective in getting the kind of behavior you want, much less transparent, and extremely difficult to dream up an administrative law doctrine that would allow review for. It doesn't guide the public, it just scares the public, right? And so, if the issue is comply or die, a vague threat from the agency is, might even be better for their purposes than a clear one. And so I think the challenge for thinking about administrative law in this area is to take seriously that disclaimer that many of us have been inclined to laugh at. The disclaimer at the top of the guidances that says, this is just advice. Well, it's not just advice. It's really a threat. But it might be a better kind of threat than other threats that are available out there for agencies to engage in. And I don't know. I think that this is in part an empirical question, right? The trade-off between what the agency gains from being clear about what it wants and what it gains by being vague, I think will vary from situation to situation. So I'm not here this morning to make a blanket claim that those kinds of citations to investigations, those kinds of selective prosecutions or investigations that will just percolate through the network of the regulated industry without there being anything on paper that says the department thinks is always worse or always better. What I'm saying is that we have to think about this as administrative lawyers in the world of the agency where it's choosing among its enforcement strategies for its bad ideas. And in that world, these guidances may not be the worst thing that we have, and if we make them less attractive, we may get, as Professor Pierce said, a solution that is worse than the problem that we have now.
Boy, that's optimistic.
Thank you very much, Aaron. So let's proceed at this point as follows. I'm going to just pose a few questions to the panel, and I'm going to address them to one particular a person, but then the others may join in, and then we will also then, in about 15-20 minutes, proceed to questions and comments from the floor. So my first question is to Richard Pierce, and it's this. Are we facing an actual sort of metaphysical problem that you cannot distinguish for purposes of law between a guidance and a regulation? Is that essentially the problem, that there just is no distinction there? I think, for example, of your suggestion that maybe the Supreme Court would have said, this is too important to proceed in so cavalier a fashion. That strikes me as a council of despair, because if there is any distinction between mere guidance and an actual legislative rule, one would think that that would be invoked in the case rather than a vague distinction between, you know, what's important and what isn't.
It's fair to say that the courts, it's an understatement to say the courts have struggled with that question. Steve Williams wrote one of my favorite opinions ever, American Mining Congress, 1994, and he started right off with, and he addressed that question, and he quoted from a whole bunch of prior opinions in which courts had tried to draw that line, and the wonderful quotes like, shrouded with mystery. In a deep, dark cloud. I mean, you know, it's a mess. Every court that's tried to address it has not been very successful. And the Supreme Court hasn't tried yet. I think the Supreme Court was about to try in the DAPA case, the case that Texas and a bunch of other states brought to the court in the immigration. And just based on my reading of the oral argument and my understanding of the chief's views on a lot of these issues, I think that they were about to come out with this how important is it, as at least one of the touchstones. Steve Williams actually came out with a four-part test. I think it's quite useful, but I think what the chief would have added is something like, well, if it's really important, you've got to treat it as a substantive rule. You've got to have notice and comment. That hasn't happened yet, so it is still, as Steve put it in his first paragraph in American Mining, shrouded in mystery. But it doesn't have to be. It is possible to draw that line.
But I guess my question is it shrouded in mystery because we have chosen to shroud it in mystery for whatever reason, or is it shrouded in mystery because it is, in fact, an unanswerable question? So, Richard, you...
I have come to the conclusion that you treat guidances that are announced as though they're final decisions in all cases. Now, this then has to face the Pierce problem, which I think is a fair one, is you get thousands of these things, and most of them are perfectly innocuous. And I think my answer to that question is now, if they're perfectly innocuous, nobody's going to bother to sue one way or another. With respect to them. So that what you're really worried about is not the number of good guidances or bad guidances. You're worried about the aggregate effect of the bad guidances. And if you get one Dear Colleague letter, which causes $10 billion worth of damage or whatever the number turns out to be, you would like to be able to challenge that ex ante so that people do not have to face the Dombrowski and Pfister risk of the only way you find out what the law is to risk going to jail. And so I think a facial challenge to all of these things is appropriate. The second thing I think that's appropriate is that the Supreme Court and all the other people, I don't think they realize the danger of the following kind of rule, which says, oh, you've got an individual sexual harassment case. We will figure out what its merits are, and it will surely count as a point in your favor if you put together some elaborate administrative structure which deals with these things in advance so that we're confident that you can do it. The moment you start doing that, then no longer is Title IX or any of these other titles simply a directive to you on how to behave. It now gives an agency a complete structure on how it is that they could take their former members and get them hired by various institutions in order to deal with the kind of compliance stuff. And so I am essentially just absolutely appalled at the extent to which the issues that you have here are not issues that are going to the merits of the individual cases, but issues in which you're required to tech up in one way, shape, or form or another to deal with these things in ways that create sort of an internal police force. And then you have to hire people in these particular offices who have good relationships with the government, which means that you create the fifth column inside the organization so that it becomes very difficult for them to make any kind of independent situation. So the rules that I would say is, and I believe this for a long time, is we have to get away from the notion of concrete industry as being subject to the standing test and understand that if there is a general rule that anybody should be able to challenge it, because otherwise nobody can be able to challenge it, and then rely on the selection effect and other things controlling discovery costs and so forth to deal with this particular issue. And so I don't think we want to make that kind of distinction. And if we put them in this particular case, I think that we will be able to shut down a large amount of this kind of behavior. So I have become, I don't want to draw the distinction anymore. I think that the government gets 99% of what it wants out of a guidance with zero procedural and substantive constraints. That's just too high a price to pay. So treat them all as final orders.
So if resurrection of a line between legislative rules and various forms of guidance is an illusion, that is not going to be a promising way of reforming administrative law. Listening to Richard's last answer, it seems to me that he pointed to two other features of administrative law that might be more promising. He didn't give them these words, but to give them their administrative law terminology. Mm-hmm. The first issue is, how do we define final agency mm-hmm. action?
Sure.
And the way it is now defined, it allows the agency to impose enormous costs on regulated parties before there can be any possibility of review. So I would like to ask, I guess, turn to Aaron and the other Richard. So is that a promising way of trying to deal with this problem, is through expanding the idea of final agency action to allow challenges to any agency action that is going to impose enormous costs, whether or not it's final in the traditional sense?
You
want to
go first, Gail, or you want me to go first, Richard?
Let me try a generic answer to it. First of all, I think directionally that is a promising direction, and there's a lot of encouraging signs. There's Sackett and what the folks at Justice calls Son of Sackett. Can't remember the name of it, but the more recent. But both of those cases expand the scope of final agency action, make it much easier to get to court in some important regulatory context at a much earlier stage in a proceeding than previously was the case. Those cases, we don't know yet how they're going to play out in the circuit courts, but I see brief after brief that refers to them in arguments before circuit courts. I think we are going to see movement in that direction. There is a circularity problem, though. In a sense, what the courts, the final agency action doctrine is triggered by whether something has legal effect. And so we're trying to figure out whether these things have legal effect.
I just to interrupt for a second, I don't mean this question to be solely an interpretive question of the Administrative Procedure Act that we have now. What I'm thinking about is what an Administrative Procedure Act for the modern world should look like, because there are members of Congress today who are asking these questions. What can we do to rein in an oppressive administrative state? And they do not know the answers. In the great division of labor in a democracy like ours, our job as scholars is to try to come up with the ideas, and then their job as legislators is to get them through. And so my question is, which of the various moving pieces within administrative law are promising places for reform? And if it is not promising, because it's an unanswerable question, it's not promising to try to revive the distinction between legislative rules and guidance, is it promising to expand the idea of final agency action to eliminate the circularity problem that you're talking about? And so, for example, if the agency's preliminary action, non-final action, imposes significant costs, is that a promising way of approaching the problem?
Because there's going to be a huge amount of self-selection. Who's going to spend $1 million to challenge a rule that costs them 50 cents? And, I mean, when I look at all of these cases, I can't find a single one in which one would say the party who's doing this is doing out of malice, spleen, or spite. What it turns out is they have desperate questions on how to run their internal organization. So Jonathan, in some of these Texas cases that you have on, you know, do you or do you not take child molesters and put them into child care type situation? You have to make these hiring decisions on day one, and then you have to make budgetary allocations upon them. And you realize that if you do it in the wrong way, that you're going to be wiped out by one of these things. It seems to me that you have every reason in the world, given your need to make internal accommodations with respect to a pending rule, to want to be able to challenge it to begin with. And once the government knows that you can challenge it, it's going to change the substantive content that they're going to put there. They're going to back off because they will find that they can't do it. I mean, I read these guidance counselors and the abusive precedent in the way in which they just look at preliminary cases in Gloucester County and everything else is just absolutely astonishing how far prepared they're prepared to go because they're afraid that no one's going to challenge them. So to give you the one obvious example, the requirement that in all of these harassment cases you use a preponderance of evidence standard and don't allow cross-examination, every single university has capitulated to this. And I don't think there's a single one of them which would do this on their own particular motion, which means that drawing and quartering various members of the Civil Rights Commission is the only appropriate sanction. So what about bodily torture as a potential remedy?
Okay, so this is one, we now have one concrete proposal for administrative law reform on the floor. May I ask Aaron, and then I'm going to come back to Gail with a different question, but Aaron, if you could,
I don't think
if you could reform
one
piece of the Administrative Procedure Act, what would it be?
I don't think finality has a lot of potential because I think that the core sense of the current APA that you can't review things until they're at least done in some sense is very sensible. And I also think that the regulated world necessarily reacts to things before they're final. And so I don't see a lot of, you know, the advanced notice of proposed rulemaking. Before the notice of proposed rulemaking, if I'm a regulated person, I'm going to react to that thing. But treating that as reviewable strikes me as very difficult to do, even if I could write the APA from scratch. I think if I had one place to go in the APA, it would be to get at this investigations and informal. The silence about informal adjudication is, to my mind, the place that gives agencies another way in that is essentially entirely unregulated and functions as a substitute to the things that we try to control. And so if the goal is to create an environment for agencies where they can't do whatever they please, you gotta go and do something about those.
Okay, but I hear the word divide. Something. I would like to know what is it?
I think some less onerous form of the formal adjudicatory procedures where you at least demand a record and a decision maker that's somewhere between due process, but I do not have a draft of a better APA in my back.
So I think, I mean, in many ways, Richard's introduction was quite splendid because he tried to get us to think about administrative law against the backdrop of other systems. And I think about criminal law, for example, and before they can come rifling through your papers, they have to have probable cause, and that can be challenged. So is it possible to say, well, why don't we bring that principle into administrative law, and before they can have an investigation, which really amounts to sending people in and rifling through your papers, that's what it's all about, before they can do that, they have to be able to establish probable cause. Of course, the most important piece here isn't evidence of wrongdoing. It's actually whether there is a law out there which you might have violated. Anyway, I'm wondering, is it possible to bring into administrative law some way for people to be able to challenge the investigations for lack of a legal basis before they take place? Could that be done? Gail?
I want to comment on something else here rather than
okay,
answer
well,
that.
Okay, well, can we get that and then you'll be next, okay? But I'd be curious, is this possible, Aaron?
No.
I'm going to agree with Richard and then let him say why.
Look, I mean, the problem is how you structure investigations is a very important question. And the way in which it's done in responsible areas is what you do is you do a general investigation that doesn't require you to get access to the private papers and conversations of people, say, in the antitrust world, looking at price movements. And then when you think that that stuff is strong enough, you say, I now have enough information based upon the information that I get without invading private rights that I now can get a warrant to do this particular kind of search. And so the question is, can you put that particular procedure into this particular context? And I think you cannot do that, because what you're not trying to do is to find wrongdoing under a given particular rule like you are in a securities investigation. What you're constantly doing is expanding the envelope of what's wrong. And so the point that I made in the original talk is, I regard the anti-discrimination laws in competitive industries as an outrage, precisely because they are capable of this infinite kind of expansion when market solutions work extremely well. And unless you come back and define more narrowly the substantive law, if the substantive law is broad, then the relevant considerations are going to be correspondingly broad. And then if you use the standard discovery rules on this, you will not be able to sort of shut these things down. And so I think that all the administrative procedure stuff is essentially stopgap, and one has to sort of fundamentally think over the question of why it is that the federal government is trying to tell a university how it ought to operate its own internal affairs. And I think the answer is they have no business whatsoever in any way, shape, or form with respect to any of these operations. That doesn't solve the problem of things which are genuinely public, where the regulatory system has to take place, licenses and so forth. But if you define more narrowly the nature of the offense, then you could define more narrowly the nature of the investigation, and you could get into the pattern. But the pattern of investigation that you're talking about, in a world in which you have disparate impact violations and sexual harassment based upon what takes place off campus, you'll never be able to narrow the investigation, given the traditional definitions of relevance, to this very broad substantive offense.
And now, Gail?
You started out talking about whether or not it was you were able to draw any sort of conceptual distinction between guidances and rules. And what I worry about is it's also very hard to draw a conceptual line between guidances and sort of lunch talk. The Secretary of Education gives a speech where he says something, and that's a guidance. I mean, that's a guidance. I mean, it's a policy statement. If you have a rule that makes it easier to regard a guidance as final agency action, I mean, we've still got like sort of standing and ripeness issues here that help somewhat, but that's a very, very difficult line to draw, when I think actually the abuses tend to be in particular areas of the government. I mean, OCR at the Department of Education, I think, has done a lot of this. So rather than look at it as a change in the Administrative Procedure Act, many of these things, should be built into the substantive statutes so that they're aimed at the particular agency that is, in fact, the abusive one. And so, like, with some of these spending clause statutes, like Title IX, I appreciated Richard Pierce's statement about, a clear statement rule ought to be used in that situation, and not deference to the agency's interpretation of its rules. I mean, you mimic contract law there. The person that drafts the statute or drafts the contract has it construed against them. But also there may be ways to make less at stake for colleges and universities, so that if OCR is forbidden to whack too much out of a school's budget simply because it has not complied with OCR's view of what Title IX requires, if you could make less turn on it, then maybe you could decrease, less in terms of the funding. And bringing the EEOC into this as well as OCR, the investigations cost a lot of money. Can there be some triggering event during the course of an investigation where at that point the investigated party is able to go in and seek a declaratory judgment that there's nothing there, and after that point, or after the point that the court determines is the appropriate point, however we define that, attorney's fees flip so that the the governmental agency is going to have to pay for the investigation costs that the employer, in the case of the EEOC, or the school, in the case of OCR, that they would have to then reimburse for the cost they've imposed on that institution. I know I would see targeted changes in the law that look for the agencies that are the most abusive would be useful here.
I agree with Richard, Gail, and Aaron, and your answer to your question, Mike. That is not a promising avenue at all, but I'd add another reason for it. That's basically chapter 4 of my treatise. It's the one I never worry about. I never change it. It's been the same since 1536. And for reasons that are always going to be there. Those reasons are illustrated by VW and years of fraudulent emissions tests, by the Austin-based ice cream company that was killing people and knew it was killing people with the ingredients of its ice cream, with Wells Fargo, who for years knew that they were defrauding. I mean,
Wells Fargo is a different case.
Bullshit.
No, it's not.
Yeah, that's why the CEO was canned.
Well, shows you what a mob mentality can do. If you're going to equate a fact when a company is defrauded by its own officers with a case in which they're murdering, killing other people, that's a lack of proportion on the way things go. I mean, that was a pretty well-run bank. They fired large numbers of small people. The actual amount of harms in those cases could be measured as $100.
But let's not get into that.
No, but the point is you have to keep...
Let's stick with VW, we know the millions they killed with excess NOx emissions around the world.
So before we go to the audience for questions and comments, I would like to give Gail the floor again to explain why she believes that Title IX does not support the transgender guidance.
Oh, there's so many reasons. Okay, as you know, Title IX prohibits discrimination on the basis of sex. Now, one could just look at that and say, well, gender identity and sex are not the same thing. I have searched in vain for some use of the term sex or sex discrimination in a way that would make the transgender guidance make sense. And when Title IX was passed in 1972, there just isn't one. But more importantly, I think, you know, there's a regulation here. There's Title IX itself that says no sex discrimination. Then there's the regulation duly authorized and signed by President Gerald Ford, as Title IX rules are required to be signed by the president. And what it says is that despite Title IX, it's okay to separate by sex for toilets, locker rooms, and showers. So it's okay. Note that that is permissive. It doesn't say you have to separate by sex. It says you can. Okay. OCR takes a case that is actually a Title VII case, and that is Price Waterhouse. Price Waterhouse involved a woman who was said to have an aggressive personality. And she says, when she doesn't get the promotion to partner, and there's a lot of other issues in the case as well, but she says, look, I was discriminated against on the basis of sex, because if I'd been a man with that same aggressive personality, I would have gotten the promotion. And I didn't. And the court says, yeah, we get that. That's sex discrimination. If you were a man, you would have gotten the promotion. You're a woman, and therefore you didn't. And that's sex discrimination. And a lot of people have looked at that case and said, well, hallelujah, that basically covers the transgender situation generally. And OCR has attempted to apply that decision to the bathroom cases. Wait a second. You can say Gigi, that is the plaintiff in the case that's going to the Supreme Court. Gigi is an anatomical female. Gigi identifies as a male, prefers male pronouns, but Gigi is a girl. And you can say, look, you know, if she were an anatomical male, she'd have been able to use the boys' room, or he'd have been. I don't really much care about the pronouns, just forgive me on this. Gigi would have been able to use the boys' room. But that's also true for all the other girls. If they were boys, they'd have been able to use the boys' room, but they're not boys, they're girls. And so that fits, that sounds like it fits Price Waterhouse until you remember, wait a second, that's what the rule says, that you can separate by sex. I mean, that's the whole point here. They're the rule, the permissive rule, they don't have to do this. They can combine everybody in the bathroom if they want to, or they can do it by social security number, or they could do it by gender identity. All of that would be perfectly legal because Title IX says you can't sex discriminate, and the rule says, but that doesn't apply to separation in bathrooms. So basically, the field for separation in bathrooms is wide open. Unless it's prohibited by some other statute, you can do it on any basis that you want. Gender identity, sex, anatomically. How you can get a rule that is permissive like that and turn that into a mandatory rule is beyond me. I don't think it can be done. Price Waterhouse doesn't apply because even though you can say if Gigi were actually an anatomical male, she'd be able to use the boys' room, that proves too much because that's true for all the anatomical females. If they were anatomical males, they could use the boys' room. But they're not, and that's specifically authorized. And so this is a real stretch, I think, to get to this. Interestingly, the use of the word gender in the way that's now become quite fashionable, a notion that, you know, you could identify. That actually was being used for the first time a couple of years before Title IX was passed. And if you look at some of the underground newspapers involved at the time, but they specifically used it as distinct from sex. So even if weirdly enough members of Congress were reading underground newspapers in the LGBT community at the time, they still would have not seen gender identity and sex as the same thing. Not that it matters, because if this were viewed as gender identity discrimination, if there were a statute that says gender identity discrimination is illegal, that would mean that you couldn't discriminate against Gigi in the sense that you couldn't allow anatomical females to be treated different, who identify as males, to be treated differently from other anatomical females who identify as female. And so at this point, we're talking about four different bathrooms, I think, and 6, 8, 12. Because, of course, there aren't just two genders. There are an infinite number, evidently.
So thank you. The suggestion here is that we now have more bathrooms. That seems like a very good idea to me. But what we really need is more time. And so at this point, I'd like to turn the floor over to... I see Earl Maltz first and then Jonathan Mitchell.
As I listen to all of this, it occurs to me that none of this is going to work unless you solve the problem of capture. That ultimately it all revolves around the problem of capture, particularly in the OCR type situations. And Richard Epstein's point, I believe it was Richard Epstein who made the point, is it's now not only OCR that has been captured, they have extended their capture to universities generally, and I don't see how any procedural fix is going to work in these situations unless you can somehow solve the problem that, and I guess OCR is the classic problem of who goes to work for an OCR, who goes to work as a diversity officer in universities, and, you know, and then there's also the industry of why we all have to look at those cartoons about sexual harassment, right? You've all had to look at those cartoons. So I guess this is really pessimistic, but I don't know if that's a comment or a question or I give up.
I think it's a question. I think it's a fair question. And look, one of the things I think that's so clear is if you look to the amount of attention that's placed on regime change. Who's going to be running OCR and so forth? It's exactly the response to that. If you have a Gail Heriot running this office instead of a Benita Gupta or whatever it is who's running whatever it is that you're doing, this is just, you know, black and white, doesn't even begin to capture it. Everything completely starts to revolve in the opposite direction. And I think the central point is you never want to have statutes on the books in which change of personnel can yield such enormous differences. And yet if you have this kind of discretion on how you define these things, that's exactly what it is that's going to happen. So I quite agree. I mean, when you say you have to prepare a constitution so that enlightened statesmen will not always be at the helm, there's two ways to think about that. One is sort of checks and balances and so forth, and I think that's underpowered. It doesn't do the job. What you really have to do is to immediately understand that the kinds of rules that you pass create a levels of discretion that are much more administrable, so you're doing driving tests instead of trying to figure out how you restructure university environments. And unless you get that kind of thing down, you're going to be faced with these futile differences amongst them. And so I agree with Richard, you know, the pollution guys and the poison guys, that's perfectly appropriate for administrative law. But telling a university how to organize its gyms and its classes is not. They're internal administrators who ought to be doing that.
Jonathan?
How do we solve the problem of unilateral disarmament? So we have a new administration about to take power. There's going to be presumably pressure from Republican constituents and conservative interest groups for these new agencies to misuse guidance documents and abuse these prerogatives in the way that Obama's people did. And let's suppose, Gail, you are appointed to run OCR. If you stand on principle and say, no, I'm not going to issue these guidance documents to advance conservative policy goals, we all know the Democrats, when they retake the White House, will reinstitute all these guidance documents to deal folks on day one. So how do you avoid appearing like a chump, essentially, to not use this tactic when the Democrats have used it for the last 8 years? We all know they will continue to use it if they get back in power. Is there any mechanism that can be used in the an executive order from Trump could be revoked by the next president, an OLC opinion could be revoked. Is there anything that can be done in this way? And I was going to just suggest one idea, which is also a topic on the panel discussion, is consent decrees. Perhaps the Trump administration should settle the lawsuits that have been brought against these guidance documents by entering into a consent decree that permanently forbids any future executive officer from reviving this stuff. Now, that's also a dangerous thing. That tool can be abused. Michael's written on this. I'm not sure. I mean, what is the best answer to this problem?
So, Gail, can you take a stab at that?
The best answer for me right now is to say I always stand on principle. And that's my final answer.
No, look, I mean, if you stop it for 4 years, that's a positive situation. If you change the climate of opinion, it will make it more difficult when these organizations get some additional life for the Democrats to come back in and do the same thing, because the natural constituents that support them inside the universities will have been diminished over the 4 years in question. But I think the worst thing that you want to do is to try to lock up the future in the same illicit fashion. If you're going to try to get permanent changes, it has to be on the substantive dimension. And what you want to do, for example, is to put a statutory definition of harassment which parallels the Supreme Court definition, rather than allowing these dreamboats to come up with an idea that if I look at you cross-eyed, I've managed to engage in harassment, and anytime somebody takes offense at me, which is all the time, then I've engaged in harassment. I mean, I think you do want to do that, and some statutory stuff I think is important.
Aaron, do you have a take on this?
The first thing I would say is that some back and forth is not so bad. So I'm not ready to say that each, with each change of power, the goal needs to be to lock yourself in a way that will be election-proof on the next round. Anyone happy about this election should be glad that things are not election-proof, and so too for the next one. So that's the first thing I would say. And secondly, I think the best mechanism we have is the United States Code. It's not consent decrees. To take the judge's suggestion and think about rewriting the APA is a better idea than an indefinite consent decree, and to fix the substantive statutes is a better idea too.
But Jonathan Stowe is asking a game theory question here, and it is, should constitutional conservatives, to the extent that they are going to have important roles in the new administration, and I don't know what the answer is to that. But if they do, do they behave themselves and thus just leave, and knowing that as soon as the wheel turns, it's going to be just as bad again the next time? Or do they play a game strategy of tit for tat and say, look, we've got to, you know, if the Obama administration uses this weapon, we've got to use it too?
Yeah, well, the problem is you'll use it for bad ends. That is, there's nothing which says that because conservatives come in and now given things that they will do the right thing, even if they don't do what the Democrats have done. And I think that you have to keep to the consistent procedural line, and then on the basis of your performance, try to win re-election. I mean, the idea that somehow or other conservatives are going to be immune to corruption because Democrats are subject to it strikes me as being very, very naive. And so I basically say you take the high road, reform the statutes, and you don't spend your time trying to figure out how to finagle in ways that immediately will subject you to all sorts of procedural objections. Look, I mean, we do know everything's going to flip about. There's all this famous talk. I mean, Cass wrote this wonderfully stupid article explaining how it is that the executive branch is the most knowledgeable branch in government. And now, of course, since it's Trump people, it's the least knowledgeable branch in government. We don't want to get ourselves into that particular point where we have celebrations so long as we know that we're in or out of power. You want to try to figure out ideal subjects for good and bad times. And unless you can control the substantive entry points into these systems, the procedural guidances that you can create will be always inadequate to the challenge. And I think that's the first lesson you learn. Anyone who's ever studied the FCC, anybody who's ever studied zoning, anybody who's ever studied labor law will realize the fact that the second order stuff can do 10% of what is needed. Substantive stuff has to do the other 90.
Another question?
Can I just add something here? I know I said that was my final answer, but there are certain mechanisms that get neglected that I think are the high road and are not used enough, and that is when you've got a misbehaving agency, cut its budget. I don't understand why Congress has not been willing to do that. They should have done that. We had a Republican Congress, easily could have cut OCR's budget, but they were too timid to do it. Instead, at the suggestion of the Obama administration, they gave OCR a 9% increase. A year or so ago. Nobody else was getting a 9% increase. That's a huge increase in the federal government. And, you know, that is the high road. That's the political mechanism you're supposed to use when you have a misbehaving agency. And Congress has been unwilling to do it, and they need to be kicked in the pants on that.
I see a hand right here, and then to the back. Go ahead.
I had wanted to follow up on Professor Sager's comments. You had reminded me of Kenneth Culp Davis's point that an agency can implement its policies just as effectively in many ways through a series of adjudications as it can through promulgating an interpretive rule. And you had made the point that if regulated entities look at the pattern of enforcement actions that an agency is bringing, it can divine how an agency is interpreting a particular regulation just as much as through interpretive guidance. As a response to the point that you had made, I thought about in the First Amendment context that we draw a distinction between the prior restraints, the chilling effect of an injunction where a particular interpretation of a statute is imposed by a court ahead of time, as opposed to after the fact criminal prosecutions, after the fact civil lawsuits. And so I wonder, do you think that an interpretive rule agency guidance ahead of time can have a similar chilling effect, or do you think instead that whether you do something through an interpretive rule or just a series of adjudications, that as a practical matter, it has the same effect on the regulated community?
I think it varies by the industry that you're regulating. I think in the case of schools, I guess all of the panelists have said now, schools are quite craven about these things and very risk averse, both. You know, one of these things about these low level adjudications is they used to be hard to get, and they're not hard to get anymore. And so I think that it is very hard, to my mind, to draw a line between a guidance being somehow prior and not the adjudications that are on the web being similarly prior, especially if the guidance says at the top, this is just friendly advice to you about what we are thinking. I think there would have been a stronger distinction back in the day where you had to go to Washington and find the right file drawer in order to get your hands on resolution agreements than it is.
Look,
now.
I, I want to put the following observation. I think Kenneth Culp Davis was wrong on this particular point. If you get a guidance and you make it work right, what you get is instant universal capitulation. If you start to go and now sue somebody, that person actually has some incentive to fight you. And if it turns out that the early discovery and preliminary motions go against the government, it turns out that that's a signal which is very powerful for other people to simply disregard it. And if they are perfect equivalents, there's no reason to explain, there's no way to explain the rise of a guidance. People would be perfectly happy to do the other thing. But if, suppose we were to now go forward to the Obama administration and say, you know what, we'll let you do anything you want by way of adjudications, but nothing by way of dear colleague letters. Do you think they would have been indifferent to that? No. They would have basically regarded that as a catastrophe. Adjudication is much riskier than guidance is there. Higher cost, higher risk, and lower returns.
Let me agree with Richard on that and also provide a partial response to the, I think, quite legitimate concern that Aaron raised. There is now and has been for 30-some years a doctrine that says an agency gets no deference with respect to its interpretation of an ambiguous statute or rule in the context of any penalty case. In that case, you do have a clear statement requirement, and it's required by due process. And the Supreme Court embraced that principle in Christopher versus Smith, Klein, Beecham, and then expanded it to include any situation in which you're talking about a significant adverse effect on anyone. You cannot do anything that has a significant adverse effect on anyone based on your interpretation of an ambiguous provision in a statute or rules. That has to have been covered by some sort of a clear statement rule in advance. So the courts have really provided, I think, at least a partial response to that problem.
And so you're saying that neither Chevron nor our deference applies in an enforcement action?
That's correct. And that's been true since at least 93 in the D.C. Circuit. The Supreme Court ratified the whole thing in Christopher versus Smith, Klein.
Does anybody follow that?
Broaden it.
This is complete news to me.
Me too.
Well, it's a law.
Yeah. Well,
I mean, take for example the Gloucester County case. That's an enforcement action against the school, and it was decided on the basis of our deference.
I haven't read it, but if so, somebody blew it.
Well, I mean, but
either the judge or the lawyers blew it.
I was part of a team representing a hotel chain which got clobbered by the FTC because of its what the FTC thought were its sloppy protections for consumer, you know, for information like credit card information, and there was literally no law on the subject, nothing. And the company got clobbered, and what the FTC cited in court were 50 consent decrees, none of which were, all of which said there's no finding of liability here. 50 consent decrees, and the Third Circuit said that's fine, that's good enough.
I would have won that case. Read General Electric versus Gilbert, 1993. This has been the law for.
Let's move to the gentleman toward the back there.
I just want to say to Richard that I don't think he's right about the difference between adjudication and guidance and as strong a version as he has stated it. The resolution agreements in the transgender cases that the department cites are They had a pile of complaints. They picked which ones to investigate. They found schools prepared to roll over. Yes. I don't have a lot of information about how those things went, but those schools, as Gail said, had no interest in fighting back.
Well, I understand.
They put their paws in the air, and what the result was roughly what the result of the guidance was.
No, if there's going to be situations where people want collusive litigation, that's fine. I mean, not fine, but that's what happened. That was the point I made that Earl picked up on, is that what happens is these organizations, in fact, have a lot of support inside it. So if there's a kind of a complex situation inside the organization and the dominant faction can make a deal with the government in order to bind the rest of the group in its favor, they will do that. But that is not the same thing as having litigation against Jonathan in Texas, right, against the Obama administration, where that was just not on the cards. And indeed, one knows what is it. I mean, the reason I so dislike many of these consent decrees is that they are basically collusive ways in which to prevent third parties from making legitimate challenges to what is going on. I will recall a situation where I blew my top. This is very uncommon. And there was a consent decree with the question as to whether or not the city of New York could send children to Catholic situations, given that the Catholics would not advise on birth control methods or provide abortions for these kids. And so there's this splendid consent decree between the ACLU on the one hand and the city of New York saying that this was perfectly okay. And so I raised the question to Fritz Schwartz and Bert Newborn. I said, this is really wonderful. Was the Catholic Church involved in this litigation? They said, of course not. They were not an interested party in the particular case. They didn't have standing, and they certainly had no right to intervene. Well, I mean, if that's the kind of thing you're going to do procedurally, is to get collusive deals in which the real party in interest is systematically excluded from the consent decree, I regard that as skullduggery, whether it's done by Republicans or by Democrats. And any court that's willing to tolerate that, I think, deserves a very sharp degree of public condemnation.
So quickly, I just wanted to make an observation about you all began your remarks in a way kind of conceding the sense in which you feel there's been overreaching by agencies. But the overreaching really could take one of two forms, it seems to me, and sometimes you're each clear about the ways in which you think it's overreaching, and other times you're a little more ambiguous. So it comes out as a result of the texture of administrative law, but and I wanted to highlight this ambiguity. So on the one hand, one could say that the overreaching is procedural, that is the failure to comply with notice and comment. And I take some of you to be kind of honing in on that point. And then the other set of you think there's overreaching for substantive reasons, that is that the guidance documents are themselves not consistent with the underlying statutes. And so it's just, I think, important that we not totally run these two things together because they call for very different kinds of solutions, it seems to me. The problem is that the texture of administrative law makes it very, very difficult to control when you're going to require the procedures. And this is something that each of you has been saying in somewhat different ways, and I just wanted to kind of make it salient. I think the American Mining Congress test is, the best we've got, but really not great. And in the end, the agencies really do have a certain degree of discretion to be able to decide when they're going to call something an interpretation or label it a statement of policy. And I think that the more urgent need seems to me, I mean, you can hassle Congress to try to fix the statutes, but that is not a very reliable tactic. What I think is much more necessary and is always indicated by these cases that come up when people are challenging that the agency should have used notice and comment rulemaking, and then we get these decisions where courts try to figure out, well, I just don't know whether this is an interpretation or a legislative rule, and the American Mining Congress case tells me something. This big important question thing that maybe Roberts would have done would go some ways towards helping this. But the it seems to me that the real problem is our, and I don't think that many people think our is a really good idea. I mean, I know there's Adrian Vermeulen, and I know there are a few people here that think that's a good idea. But Scalia understood very well why it was a bad idea, and I think we should be pushing much, much harder against it, especially in these contexts. And what we should be telling courts is, forget about it. You are not going to be able to figure out whether this is an interpretive rule or a legislative rule. Take the agency's word for it, but don't give them any deference. And I don't think courts are that resistant to it. When you look at some of these cases, like the no action letter cases with the SEC and the Second Circuit, they know full well that these things don't deserve deference, and they don't want to give deference to them. And I think it's important that while we talk about this stuff, we short circuit in some ways the notice and comment problem, because I think the standards that we are trying to get here, as I think Michael made clear, there's actually kind of a metaphysical problem here it's not a big surprise the courts can't solve that problem. What's not that complicated for courts to do is to say something like Gail is saying, which is, this is not what Title IX means under any plausible reading. And that's what you want the court to say, not, well, you should have done notice and comment.
So why not overrule Chevron and Dower? Just both of them, right? I mean, Chevron's crazy. Rules of law questions should always be decided de novo by appellate courts.
So may I just comment in reaction to your question? I think what you're saying is that it is the substantive abuse that's the problem, and I agree with that. But the reason why notice and comment is important is because when you have a regulation through notice and comment rulemaking, it can then be challenged pre-enforcement under the APA for being arbitrary, capricious, or contrary to law, right? And that means the trade association can go in. You don't have the embarrassment of an enforcement proceeding. You can go in proactively and say, no, that is a misinterpretation of the law. If there is no notice and comment rulemaking, but instead a guidance that can't be challenged, then you've got each individual victim who is the target of an investigation, you pick them off one at a time, and they all end up settling, consent decrees, whatever, and you'll never get to court on the question of whether the agency interpretation is contrary to law or not.
Unless you follow my de novo rule. That is, any time you announce a guidance, you treat it as though it's a final judgment, and you allow anticipatory attacks. I mean,
okay,
I asked
you the question of whether final agency action is a useful
he
way of
said
going
no,
about
I
this.
I said yes.
Oh, okay.
I mean, my view is that I want both of them. I think you pass a statute which says overrules Chevron, overrules Dower. And essentially then announces, to the extent that there are these things, you can challenge them, and in each and every case you treat the actions of an agency as though it is simply an action with no particular deference, and decide the question on the merit just as though it were a dispute between two private parties.
So Richard Pierce, is that what do you say to that?
I think the discussion of Chevron and Auer is not something I want to begin 2 minutes after the end of a program. It's something I have addressed over a period of many hours.
Is that A-U-R-E-S or H-O-U-R-S?
But I agree completely. A lot of this really is tied up. The final agency action bit of this is important and ties in and slash reviewability, stage of review. That really is, I think, terribly important, independent of whether there's any deference involved.
Well, we now are just over time, so let's thank the panel for those interesting remarks.